Good afternoon, everyone. Marc Brown is the creator, author, and illustrator of that beloved third-grade aardvark named... What's his name? I need that a little bit louder. Oh, of course, his name is Arthur. More than 66 million Arthur books are in print right now in the United States, and the PBS television show Arthur is the network's most watched children's program and the winner of 6 Emmy Awards. And along with his wife, Laurie Krasney Brown, he is also the creator of the critically acclaimed nonfiction Dino Life Guides for Families series. Marc was honored by the Associates of the Boston Public Library in 1998 as a literary light, and given a Lifetime Achievement Award at their Literary Lights for Children event in 2004. Arthur is an iconic aardvark. And as a children's librarian, you get to see firsthand how children respond to these iconic characters. And I've seen how strongly kids of all backgrounds relate to Arthur. When he's faced with tough situations and new issues, Arthur responds in the ways that a third grader would. And kids find comfort in the fact that even when he makes mistakes, as any third grader certainly does, that he can rely on his family, his friends, and himself. Marc Brown is that rare grown-up who remembers what it's really like to be a kid, and his beloved characters continue to act as guides for children in a changing world. Please help me welcome warmly Marc Brown to the Lowell Lecture Series.
Oh, that's a great introduction. Thank you. It is so good to be here today. Another beautiful day in Boston. Well, you know, I was listening to one of the Arthur programs the other day, and I thought, the theme song for Arthur pretty much sums up what it is I want to do with my books and television shows. So let's take a listen. I thought that was a good place to start.
Every day when you're walking down the street, everybody that you meet has an original point of view. And I say, hey, hey, what a wonderful kind of day. If we could learn to work and play and get along with each other. You got to listen to your heart, listen to the beat, listen to the rhythm, rhythm of the street. Open up your eyes, open up your ears, get together and make things better by working together. It's a simple message and it comes from the heart. Oh, believe in yourself.
Well, you know, I think of you kids as my boss now, because I got fired from a lot of different jobs. Yes, it's true. I was a truck driver. I kept getting lost. I got fired. I was a short order cook. I couldn't figure out what catch a fish, hit it with rye, and put a pair of shoes on it meant. It happens to be a tuna fish sandwich on rye bread to go. So, I was a TV art director, and they didn't think that dressing the weather woman up as a weather fairy was a good idea. And then I was working at a college here in Boston, and it closed. And so I went home that night, and my new job magically appeared. I told my son a bedtime story about a little aardvark, and I figured that, you know, maybe that would be something. It kind of put together all the things I really loved doing. Working with kids, drawing, and making up stories. Now, a teacher asked me a really good question. This is something for you to think about. She said, if you were a bumper sticker, what would it say? So you kind of have to think about what it is you stand for in just a very few words. And I thought, my bumper sticker would say, I like all kids and some adults. That would be in much smaller type. Because I think of you guys now as my boss, I love my job, and I never, ever want to hear you say you're fired. So today for our little talk, I know we're going to have some time at the end for some questions, because you guys have some excellent questions. But I decided to put my talk together based on all the great questions I get asked by kids. Because I get a lot of letters from kids. Where did I grow up? Well, I grew up in Erie, Pennsylvania. And I spent most of my childhood plotting my escape. What was I like as a kid? Well, I was a little kid with big ideas. I liked to ride my bike, play with my friends. I did like to make up stories, but I didn't remember that until I became an author. I remember asking my kindergarten teacher for more books about birds because I thought I might want to be an ornithologist. It's funny how things change. What got you started writing books? Well, that's a good question. I think when I first realized that writing picture books would be a lot of fun and interesting for me to do was when I was a senior in high school and my mom and dad had a new baby, and I was reading books to her to make her stop crying because all she did was cry and poop. And I found that the crying would stop when I read her books, and one of the books she really loved was Where the Wild Things Are. And, you know, when I read that, something really happened for me. I thought, how did this guy do this? How did he tell this wonderful story with so few words and pictures? That's something that I would like to do someday. And then I read that Maurice Sendak, he used to get a lot of letters from kids too, and one of his letters said, "Dear Mr. Sendak, we really like Where the Wild Things Are. My sister and I were thinking, if it doesn't cost too much to go there, we might like to go there over summer vacation." That's when you know it's a good book. Yes, I like to read, but I don't remember that many books when I was little. But I did grow up with great storytellers, and I think that's probably where I got this from. My great-grandmother would tell us stories about coming to America from Ireland with her 13 brothers and sisters. She was the oldest, and they were coming over, and they got stuck in an iceberg. And she was down in the bottom of this dark ship trying to take care of her little brothers and sisters and cut bread for them. And it was so dark she couldn't see what she was doing. And she cut right through the bread and she cut her hand open. And then she showed me the scar. But the best story was when she got married very young to this man and he was shot in a train robbery. My great-grandfather, he was the robber. Nobody in my family knew this, and nobody would believe me. And, you know, with Google, I started to research it, and it's a true story. And her daughter, my grandma Thora, that's where I got Arthur's grandma, she used to tell great stories, and her spooky stories were the best. She would take her false teeth out to tell those. And then my dad would take me to this magical place on Saturday mornings, the Erie Public Library. And we'd go right by the children's room. I never even knew there was a children's room. And we'd go upstairs to where they had the books on architecture. And he loved old houses. And he would show me all these books of old buildings with the fences and the windows and the doors and the stairways. And he really built this love of American architecture in me. And I think I probably would have been an architect if I were better in math. But now I've renovated 8 antique houses over the years, and I'm sure it was because of my dad's love of something. And it, you know, it really shows us when, as adults, if we are passionate about something and really love it and share it with kids, it makes this indelible impression on kids. Well, we live in two places now. For many, many years, we lived in Hingham, and now we divide our time between Martha's Vineyard. And as you know, if you go over there, you have to get on that big ferry boat. And this is one of the old houses we fixed up. It was built in 1735, so it needed a lot of work. And it happens to be in a farm. A lot of chickens. These two belted Galloway cattle that kind of look like Oreo cookies with legs. And for a while, people whose kids outgrew their ponies, they would send them over to live at the farm. And I always thought this might make an interesting book. The little pony was blind, and the bigger pony was its guide pony. And it would help the little pony find its way around the farm, just like people who are blind and have their guide dogs. A lot of ducks, a lot of geese. We just got some new pigs at the farm. That's pork chop on the left and sausage on the right. Yum! We have a lot of wild turkeys. Now, look closely. You will find a bird that is not a turkey. See that blue bird? It's a peacock. He just arrived one day and he thought he was a turkey. And he started hanging out with the turkeys, and he comes up and he gets really close to our house and he looks in the windows. It's kind of spooky, actually. And we have these two goats. That's Hannah. And the smart one up front is Hillary Clinton. And I thought it would be really good if the real Hillary Clinton met the goat Hillary Clinton. She was actually visiting our friends. And so I said, Hillary, there is a goat named Hillary Clinton here at the farm. She was not amused. We do have pets. We have these two great cats, a brother and sister, we got from the animal rescue on the vineyard. That's Lola up on top, and that's her brother Romeo down on the bottom. Well, you know, I work in two places. The place where I have the most room is on the vineyard. It's an old cow barn that I fixed up to make a studio upstairs. And if you came in, first thing you would see would be Arthur and DW keeping me company. And in New York, where we are half of the year, I work in a tiny little garden shed behind the house. And it's about 6 foot wide at the widest end and 2 foot wide at the other end. And I work while I'm standing up. I seem to get a lot more done that way. Yes, I do have hobbies. Let's see, the ones I can tell you about, I like to bake pies, and I like to grow the stuff that goes in them. And currently, I have a new hobby. Are any of you following this drama of George Washington Bridge and Governor Chris Christie? It's just like the Nixon Watergate scandal. I can't get enough of it. It's like every day there's a new revelation, and it's like he manages to just distance himself enough from the scandal. But I have a feeling that very soon he's going down. Where do you get your ideas? I get them at a large rock off of Route 95. But most of the really good ideas come from real life. Things that happen to people I know, their kids, that happen to my kids. The best stuff happens in real life. And then if it's not enough for a full-blown story, I will make notes and put them in my idea drawers. Kids send me a lot of letters. I get maybe 100,000 letters a year, and lots from schools and big packages full of kids and classes. And they ask a lot of good questions. The other day, I got a flat... Do any of you kids send flat Stanley letters to authors? Because I get lots of those. Did you do that? I got one from a flat Nate, and he put his picture on it. And he had his email address for his teacher, and I thought, well, I'm going to have a little fun with this. And so I took flat Nate, and he kind of traveled around our house, and this is what I sent back to flat Nate in his class. Here I am at Marc Brown's house. I'm standing in front of his bulletin board. Hi, this is flat Nate. They have a lot of old pictures all over the house of children that are, some of them are almost 200 years old. He lives on a busy street in New York City. The day I was there, they were filming a movie across the street. I stood in the window so I could get into the movie. He works in this little tiny building behind his house. He calls it the tomb. He has a lot of art supplies. He was working on a book about monsters, but I didn't find any monsters at his house. They have a lot of weird things. They must like to eat because there was a lot of food. And they must like to cook because there were a lot of cookbooks. This is an old map. They had the hallway lined with these old maps of New York City. And they had strange things on the table. When I looked more closely, they were Valentines that Laurie gave to Mark over the past 30 years. They had old toys. I even peeked in his closet. And they had this big cat named Lola. She was kind of scary. And then I found this cozy place to sleep. And they didn't even see me. Whoops, they just found me. I've got to go now. Bye. That's the end of Flat Nate. And his class just sent me a thank you note and a picture of the class. Okay, this is a question I get asked a lot. I think it's probably the question kids are most curious about. Because, you know, I've been writing Arthur books now for 35 years. And the very first Arthur looked a little different. Do you ever read that book about Arthur's nose? And I didn't intend to make him look different, but the more I drew Arthur, his face got rounder and rounder, and his nose kept getting smaller and smaller. Sometimes I wonder if I should feel responsible for some of the people who grow up on my books. What do you use to make your illustrations? Well, pretty simple things. Watercolor, magic markers so that the outlines of my characters don't run when I go over them with the watercolor. And then I use colored pencil for the details. And lately I've been experimenting with a lot of different kinds of art. I've been working with collage and painting the papers and gluing different photographic elements that I cut out of magazines. This was a book I illustrated on babies. That was a lot of fun. Yes, I do have those days when I can't write. And you know what I do? I clean my desk. I vacuum my studio. I think Roald Dahl had the best advice for authors. He said, you just have to keep your bottom on the chair. And I find that works too. Okay, the books I'm working on right now, the one that's being published this month, it was just published, is in New York, and that kind of happened from starting to live in New York. A few years ago, when I moved there, I thought, well, maybe I'll just go out with my camera and my sketchbook and see what I find. And the more I investigated, the more I wanted to make a book about what I was seeing. And there was so much stuff I collected, it kind of spilled over onto the end papers here. A lot of facts about the city. And it starts out with kind of how I came to really be interested in New York. One day when I was 8 years old, my family boarded a train in Erie, Pennsylvania. And when we woke up, we were in New York City, the most exciting city I've ever seen and probably ever will see. As a child, I dreamed about one day living there, and now I do, in an old house by the Hudson River. And I thought a good place to start in this book would be what New York looked like when it was founded, and it was called New Amsterdam. And it certainly looks very different than it does today. Now it's very noisy, and the kinds of noises are not from animals. Well, maybe some of them are kind of animals. One of the best things about New York City is the subway, a lot like Boston. Best way to get around. Oh, there's so many good museums. This is the Intrepid Air and Space Museum out in the Hudson River. And you can't talk about New York without talking about food. There are foods from all over the world, different kinds of wonderful things to try. My favorite is pizza. And New York has 1,600 places that sell pizza. I'm working my way around all of them. And I was talking to my editor about food in New York, and she said, oh, Mark, I was just downstairs for lunch and Liza Minnelli was eating yogurt. So there she is. I said, well, I'm going to put her in this book. This is a little shameless self-promotion. Macy's Thanksgiving Parade is one of the, I think, most fun things for kids in the city that happens every year. Now, the books that are home on my desk right now, there are two of them. This is a book a collaboration with my buddy R.L. Stine, who wrote all the Goosebumps books. Have any of you read any of those? Yeah. Well, I said, have you ever written a picture book, Bob? And he said, no. But then he started thinking about it, and he came up with Little Shop of Monsters. And he gave me all these great monsters to illustrate. These are the Yucky Mucky twins. And then last summer, I was just doodling one day when I didn't want to work on what I was supposed to be working on. And out came this little monkey who was kind of sad, and he was holding a lunchbox that looked kind of sad. And I scanned it and sent it to my editor at Knopf, and she said, I kind of like that monkey. What's he so sad about, Mark? And then it got me thinking about what he was sad about. And this whole story popped out about him kind of worried about kindergarten. What if his teacher doesn't like him? What if he gets on the wrong bus? What if he can't find the bathroom? What if he doesn't like the snacks? What if they don't have red crayons? And what if he can't remember all the letters in the alphabet? And what if he doesn't make any new friends? I thought that would be a lot to worry about. And why does Monkey have to go to kindergarten anyway? He can already count to 12, and he usually remembers most of the alphabet. And here he is the night before he's ready to go to kindergarten. He's making his lunch. He's taking something from home to make him feel better. He puts a book about bugs in his backpack. And then he counts while he's in the bathtub, and he practices alphabet while he's falling asleep. So these will all be in color when I finish the art this summer. Do I have a family? Yes, I do. This is a kind of a recent picture of most of the family that was at my mom's house in St. Augustine last Thanksgiving. And there's my mom in the middle, and my wife, Laurie, who's here today. I've collaborated on some really great books that she's written. She's the smart one in the family. And she writes books that are difficult subjects for families, like death, divorce, making friends. And then I got to draw the pictures. But she's also an artist. She's getting ready for her second one-woman show. And that's a piece of her artwork. She works in paper and screen and string and good things. She makes beautiful things with color. Where do I get the ideas from my characters? Okay, this might give you guys some ideas. Characters that you can write about are all around us every day. For instance, nobody is safe around me. Okay, this is my third grade class. Here I am in the second row. Here's Patricia Del Porto. She turned into Sue Ellen, this girl that Arthur kind of likes. And then next to her is my friend Alan. He turned into the brain. Down here was my best friend, Terry Johnson. He turned into Buster. This big kid on the side, I wonder how many years he was in third grade. He's not our teacher. His name is Clarence Jordan, and he turned into Binky Barnes. She turned into Prunella. And that's our teacher over here on the left, Miss Kingston. She used to make popcorn for us in class. And she got married the year we were in third grade. And she invited the whole class to her wedding. What was she thinking? She was great. She kind of turned into, a lot of her personality turned into Miss Sweetwater, one of the teachers in Arthur's school. And then I had this teacher in seventh grade for algebra who I couldn't forget no matter how hard I tried. And I tried really hard. He turned into Mr. Ratburn. You kids are so lucky you weren't in his class. Okay, are there any teachers here today? Okay, here's a teaching trick. In the back of his classroom, he kept a row of empty chairs. And this kept us in line and kept the classroom very quiet. He called it Death Row. And you never, ever wanted to go to Death Row. And then my sister Bonnie was kind of bossy. She liked to talk a lot. She was good at sports. And she turned into Francine. I kind of combined all three of my little sisters into one triply troubled character, DW. That's what they're like today. They're still trouble. Yeah, you don't want to mess with them. And then here's my son Tolan when he heard the first Arthur story. And a lot of his issues that he was dealing with at that age turned into Arthur books. He was afraid to go to day camp, and the same thing happened to Arthur. Tucker had a loose tooth in second grade that would not come out, no matter how hard he wiggled it. And the same thing happened in Arthur's tooth. Eliza had a little trouble with her training wheels. She wanted to take them off before she was ready. DW had the same problem. Okay, why did I turn Arthur into a TV show? Well, you know, it's been, I guess, a good idea. It's won a lot of Emmys, but what do you do with them after you win them? You know, I keep them with my tax returns. Although it's getting kind of crowded in there now. I guess I have to throw away some of the older years. But what PBS wanted to do with Arthur was to make more kids want to read by watching television. And I thought that was a wonderful use of both animation and TV. And the best role model was my buddy Fred Rogers, who I think used television in such helpful ways to kids and families. I miss him a lot. I thought I'd show you some of the clips. We did a lot of shows, things that you couldn't do in a picture book as well. Like a lot of families, including ours, have dealt with the problem of Alzheimer's. And Arthur's having some problems with his grandpa.
Are you all right, darling? Why are you standing?
This is Joan Rivers, who plays Francine's grandmother.
All the blood will rush to your feet. Sit down. How many fingers do I have?
Two.
Actually, I have 10. Last time I checked. Anyhow, you seem okay, darling. A little thin. Gonna talk to your mother.
Hey, Arthur. You met my grandma, Bubby, right?
Sure, we're old friends. You had the pizza thing when Frankel was trying to fast me Yom Kippur, remember? Frankly, I still don't know why you didn't change the date. I mean, how hard could that have been?
Want to play with us?
No, thanks. I kind of want to be alone.
What? Why do you want to be alone? Something is bothering you. Tell Bubby.
I'm fine. I'm just... It's my grandpa. He didn't remember my name the other day, and now it turns out he has this problem.
Just a sec. You mind if we have this conversation over some pastrami? This one's got me running around like a golden retriever. I'm sorry to hear that about your grandfather, Arthur.
But what can I do about it?
Nothing. Listen, Arthur, sweetheart. People change. The body changes, and brains change, too. You think I can do long division now? Forget about it. But here's the thing. Your grandfather will always be your grandfather. He's still in there, and he still loves you very, very much. Now, drink your water. Your body is 70% water, so it's just like drinking more you.
Does she ever stop moving? This is nothing. Yesterday, she alphabetized the cereal.
Wow, that was some performance. We should have this ride every year and call it the Tour de Francine.
You came. Does that mean you're all better?
Not quite, but I'm feeling pretty good today.
I'm sorry I haven't come to see you. I was afraid that...
You don't have to explain. It can be pretty frightening to see someone you care about when they're sick. There is something you could do to make it up to me, though.
Just name it.
First, put some of this hand sanitizer on.
Now what?
Now, give me a big hug.
I've really missed you.
I've missed you too, Frankie.
Welcome to you all.
Thanks for having us on the show, Larry.
Is it easy working together?
Oh, yeah.
We're great.
We really listen to each other.
Moby Dick? Sure, I'll do it. But I want 100% of the back end. And I want to be the whale.
Script for you, Mr. Damon. It's by someone named Arthur Reed.
He writes novels and comics and movies and poetry. Is there anything that Neil Gaiman doesn't write?
I've never written a cookbook.
Who's Ming Tsai?
He's the host of Simply Ming on TV.
I have to say, Muffy, that bite of quiche was a complete waste of taste buds and saliva.
Gritty, but with a hint of ennui.
Who's William Fillmore Tauchman?
He's only the most famous theater director in Crown City.
A tragic tale of love, loss, redemption, and more loss.
You're an astronaut?
Yes, sir. Mike Fink's my name, and I've spent over 365 days in space. It was amazing.
Michelle Kwan!
Coco Taylor!
You can call me Frank. I'm an architect.
Presenting the world's tallest treehouse.
Whoa!
It's a bold vision, Brain, but that would cost a fortune to build.
I know. I spent 3 months of allowance on the toothpicks alone.
It's a beautiful day here at Arthur's house, a neighborly stay here at Arthur's.
I just don't want people to make fun of me.
Real friends don't make fun of real friends.
Does he sing?
No.
Is there a light show?
No.
Does he jump around and smash his instrument?
No.
And he calls himself a musician. All right! Wow! Yeah! Hey, come on! Give it up, people! This guy can really play!
D.W., the piece isn't over yet.
Goodbye for now, yeah. Bye-bye. Will someone please tell me what was the rush? At this age, I only have two speeds, slow and stop. It's public television. Why don't we all just stop and smell the roses? Has anyone got a rose?
She was so funny during the recording sessions. Most of the stuff that she said we couldn't put in the show, but she was fun. Well, you know, it's March 2nd was Dr. Seuss's birthday. Did you know that? And I happen to have illustrated a book that celebrated Dr. Seuss. It's called... Oh, no. All right. We're not going to do that yet. First, I have to tell you about the coolest thing I ever did. Do you want to hear about it?
Yeah.
This was really cool. Okay. I got to meet 4 presidents because of Arthur. And because of that book that I wrote, Arthur Meets the President, I got to meet Barbara Bush, and she called me up and said, Mark, I like that book, and maybe you can help me with my literacy program. And so I did, and then she introduced me to her daughter-in-law, Laura Bush, and she asked me to go to Moscow to represent America at the first Russian Children's Book Festival. I got to go on Air Force One, the president's airplane. Okay, this is what it's like inside. I took pictures, even though I wasn't supposed to. Right behind that seal there is the president's apartment. There's a bedroom, a bathroom, and a little living room in there. And that's my buddy R.L. Stein, who also went to Russia. The Goosebumps guy. Here we are. We're getting ready to talk to all the kids over in Moscow. And Mrs. Bush read Arthur Meets the President. I did a lot of drawings for kids. And that's Mrs. Putin, President Putin's wife, in that tragic yellow and blue suit. And here, that night, right after we had our time with the kids, President Putin and his wife gave this big party for all the librarians in Russia. And we had first ladies from many countries around the world, and every one of them gave a toast. And after every toast, you had to drink vodka. We got kind of silly. All right, this was the last picture I took because I found out I wasn't supposed to be taking pictures. If you look carefully in the upper left-hand corner, you'll see the Secret Service agent who just discovered me with my camera. Right after I took this picture, he tackled me, and I'm on the ground, and he's trying to take my camera away from me, and I'm holding on to it. And he said, "You're not allowed to take pictures." I said, "Well, what if I erase them?" He said, "You're going to erase those pictures?" I said, "Yeah, I'm doing it right now." I have to confess, on the back of my third grade report card, Miss Kingston wrote, "Does not follow directions." I got the pictures, though. Okay, here we are with Wild About Books. And as I think you'll recognize the way the story is written. It's written by Judy Sierra, who writes great books for kids. And it's written a lot like the books that Dr. Seuss writes. It started the summer of 2002 when the Springfield librarian, Molly McGrew, by mistake drove her bookmobile into the zoo. Molly opened the door, she let down the stair, she turned on her computer, and she sat in the chair. At first, all the animals watched from a distance, but Molly could conquer the strongest resistance. By reading aloud from the good Dr. Seuss, she quickly attracted a mink and a moose, a wombat, an oryx, a lemur, a lynx, 8 elephant calves, and a family of skinks. In a flash, every beast in the zoo was stampeding to learn all about this new something called reading. Forsaking their niches, their nests, and their nooks, they went wild, simply wild, about wonderful books, choosing thin books and fat books and Cat in the Hat books, and new books and true books and heaps of how-to books. Giraffes wanted tall books, and crickets craved small books, and geckos could only read stick-to-the-wall books. The pandas demanded more books in Chinese, and Molly filled their requests, always eager to please. She even found waterproof books for the otter, who never went swimming without Harry Potter. Raccoons read alone, baboons read in bunches, and llamas read dramas while eating their lunches. Hyenas shared jokes with the red-bellied snakes, and they howled and they hissed till their funny bones ached. A tree kangaroo, who adored Nancy Drew, began solving mysteries right there at the zoo, such as, why were the bandicoot's books overdue? Can you find out why? You see any clues there? It looks like she built a little house out of her books, forgot to take them back to the library. Gently, Molly taught lessons in treating books right, for the boa constrictor squeezed Crichter too tight. Baby bunnies mucked up Goodnight Moon with their paws. Giant termites devoured the Wizard of Oz. And the bear's love of books was completely outrageous. They licked all the pictures right off of the pages. Tasmanian devils found books so exciting that soon they had given up fighting for writing. They made up adventures so thrilling and new that the others decided to be authors too. Pythons wrote with their tails, penguins wrote with their bills, and porcupines wrote with their very own quills. And then, at the new insect zoo, bugs were scribbling haiku, and the scorpion gave each of them a stinging review. I know what that feels like. It is not fun, kids. As the cheetah's new novel began to take shape, he read chapters each night to the Barbary ape. And although the gazelle couldn't spell very well, like everyone else, she had stories to tell. And imagine the hippo's enormous surprise when her memoir was given the Zulitzer Prize. With so many books, Molly knew what to do. She hired 12 beavers, a stork, and a gnu to build a branch library right there at the zoo. And then the animals cried, "We can do it ourselves. We can check the books out. We can put them on shelves." And they did. And they do up to this very day. So 3 cheers for the Zoobrary. Hip, hip, hooray. And when you visit the zoo now, you surely won't mind if the animals seem just a bit hard to find. They are snug in their niches, their nests, and their nooks, going wild, simply wild, about wonderful books. I just want to say one last thing. If I ran the zoo, all the teachers would make more money than movie stars, because what they do is a lot more important. Think about that. Thank you. Okay. We have time for a couple questions.
We are going to have some questions today, but first, you all saw that we were handing out some question sheets for children, and we've been handing them out for the last few weeks at the library, and we invited a few of those children for a special treat to come on stage to meet Mark and ask their question in person.
Okay, that sounds like fun.
We're going to start with a few of our friends.
My favorite question was from a second grader in Texas. And his teacher got them so excited about a real live author coming to visit. His question was, Mr. Brown, if you're so famous, how come you aren't dead?
How did you answer?
I had no answer for that one. Okay, let me.
All right.
I hope I have an answer for your question.
What is your name?
Shanli.
Can you say it again?
Shanli.
Oh, and how old are you?
I am 5 years old.
And what is your question?
Why Arthur doesn't have a tail?
Why Arthur doesn't have a tail? Excellent question.
He did in the first book. Mm-hmm. And then I just kind of tucked it in his jeans. That works.
You want to say thank you?
Does that sound plausible to you? Okay.
This young man also made an amazing drawing that we're going to give you to take home.
Excellent.
Come on down. Thank you.
I save kids' drawings. Thank you.
Mills, you ready?
All right, step right up in the spotlight.
Yes.
Don't be nervous.
What is your name?
Mills.
And Mills, how old are you?
8.
And what is your question for Mark today?
How did you find the way to draw your characters?
How did I find a way to draw my characters? Well, you know, people remind me of animals. If I had a piece of paper right now, I would turn you into an Arthur character. And I think I would make you into a rabbit. Does that ever happen to you where sometimes people remind you of animals? Yeah, and well, that happens to me all the time. And so that's kind of how I think of my... First, it starts from a real person, and then I build them into an animal. That's where they come from.
Thank you so much,
Mel. Thanks for the question.
And I think we have one friend from a community center in Dudley. I didn't get to meet them, so I'm not sure which of our friends is coming on stage. Who's coming with us here?
All right, Jane Opal.
You ready?
Okay, come on up.
Thank you. Here's the stairs over here, my friend.
Hi. All right, what is your name?
My name is Shane.
And Shane, how old are you?
6.
And what's your question for Mr. Brown today?
Did you make any different books?
I did. And, you know, right now I'm working on different kinds of books that don't have Arthur in them. Because I've been doing Arthur for a long time. I kind of circled back to where I started out before Arthur happened. And I'm thinking of being more of an illustrator, illustrating other authors' ideas, and writing books about other things. I'm currently working on a book about a man who painted portraits in America, right around here in New England, 200 years ago. His name was John Brewster. And he couldn't hear, and he couldn't speak. And yet he traveled all over New England, and he painted these beautiful portraits of kids and people. And I thought that was an interesting thing to do. So I like that time in history. So I'm going to go back there, and I've written a story about it. And I'm going to paint those pictures probably in the next couple of years.
Wonderful. Thank you, Shane. So
good question, Shane.
We are going to open up to questions from the audience, and Beth and I have microphones, so we're going to be walking around, and you can put your hand in the air if you have a question. While we're finding our first question, maybe I'll ask one of our other questions from a kid.
Okay.
While Beth finds the first person. And John, who is 7, had 2 questions. He wanted to know whether you went to art school to learn to draw, and also what's your favorite thing in Boston?
Oh, those are great questions. I did go to art school. I went to the Cleveland Institute of Art, a wonderful place to learn about art. And my favorite thing in Boston, I guess it's the history that we have here. And I love the fact that I can just walk into John Adams' house where he lived and he had his family there, and to know that these presidents came from our area and led this country. If you haven't read the biography of John Adams that David McCullough wrote, I've read it twice. It's just a wonderful, wonderful book. But I love history, and so the best thing for me about Boston is being able to be so close to where all these wonderful things happened long ago. Yes?
So we have a question over here.
Okay.
Nope,
all right.
Over far to your
you're
right.
The question directors. You guys take
I'm
it.
Over here. Yep. So what's your name?
Julian. Did you ever make a chapter book?
Did you ever make a chapter book?
I did. I've written about 20 chapter books now about Arthur. They're actually books that evolved from certain television episodes. Because a strange thing happened when Arthur went on TV. His audience, who wanted to read about Arthur and his friends, got younger and older at the same time. And I was spending a lot of time on the TV show, and so we used some of those television episodes to turn them into chapter books. I get letters from kids in college who get together and watch the show now. Yeah, okay.
We have a question right here. What's your name?
Lily.
And Lily, what would you like to ask?
Would you ever make an Arthur episode where D.W. and Arthur were older?
Would you ever make an episode where Arthur and D.W. are older?
Well, we've done a little of that just within some of the episodes, trying to make them look grown up or as adults. But, you know, Arthur will always be 8 years old and in third grade. He's never going to have to worry about taking the SATs. He's in a pretty good place.
We have a question right here. What's okay. your name?
Alex.
And what's your question?
How many books does Marc Brown write?
Over 100 now. I think about 120 that I've either written or illustrated. I like what I do. I like to keep busy. Yes.
Yeah. Way up here, what is your name?
Devin.
And Devin, what's your question today?
What is your favorite Arthur book, and what is your favorite character?
Favorite character and favorite Arthur book?
My favorite character is D.W. because she has all the funny lines. I love to get inside her head and put words into her mouth. I like reading Arthur's teacher trouble to kids. That's one of my favorite books to read out loud. Or Arthur's underwear. I never would have thought of that, but kids kept asking me in schools, would you write a book about Arthur's underwear? And that's how that book happened. Kids are always right. Yes.
We have a question right here in the middle. What's your name?
Danielle. And I'm a college student at the Museum of Fine Arts School. And
great school.
Yes, it's definitely an amazing school. I deeply admire how the books and the television show, they always deal with everyday issues with children, and even with some of the harder issues, like with cancer and with Alzheimer's. How do you go about tackling some of the most challenging topics, like the death of a pet or Asperger's syndromes or anything of that nature?
Well, I'm glad that you are interested in that, because it's kind of a detail that a lot of people don't know about. Because we deal with so many issues that are difficult, most people don't want to deal with those with kids. We have a wonderful advisory group, and we go to people who are specialists in those fields. We talked with a lot of people who know about cancer, and they know about families and dealing with that, and how to be helpful, what we should put in the show, what we shouldn't put in, what's age appropriate. So it's our advisors who really help us a lot. And as I was saying very quickly when I showed you that little reel about our guest stars, Matt Damon's mom, who teaches at Leslie, is one of our advisors, and she's really good, as they all are. And we have great young writers. We'll get together once a year, and we'll make a list of things that might make good shows. And one day I said, desk wars. And they wrote a whole story about kids and their desks in the classroom and the wars that they were having with each other. Or head lice. Who's going to deal with head lice? We are. Thanks.
Okay, what's your name?
Erica.
And Erica, what would you like to ask today?
Do you have any Braille books? Because my mom can't see.
Did I have any problems?
Any books in Braille? Because her mom can't see.
Yes,
to
we
read
do
them.
Have books in Braille. Yes, there are quite a few of Arthur books that are in Braille. I was working directly with the Perkins School.
Question up here in the back.
Okay.
What's your name?
Nora.
And Nora, what is your question?
Why did you choose to target young audiences?
Why did I choose to?
Target young audiences?
Target young audiences?
Yes.
That's a good question. As I mentioned earlier, Arthur and putting together stories with pictures and working with kids were the three things that I found most interesting. And if I could make a dream job doing those things, that's what it would be. And I'm lucky I have my dream job. But as my oldest son started to get older, Arthur kind of followed him. First, Arthur was in kindergarten, then he was in first grade, then he was in second grade. And I thought, what's going to happen? You know, now he's in fourth grade. Do I keep writing books about Arthur when he's younger? Or do I start writing older books? So I thought about writing a young adult novel, and I had a really good title for it, A Day at Hormone Junior High. But that never got finished. For a while there, I was thinking of turning it into a TV series called Pimples.
All right, this young lady was bouncing up and down. What is your name?
Aaliyah.
And Aaliyah, what's your question today?
When did Mark start to draw?
When did I learn?
Start to draw.
I remember getting in trouble drawing. In first grade, we had our two desks together, and my friend who sat next to me, Alan, I would draw race cars and jet planes and things for him, and we'd kind of talk about those things. But I was supposed to be doing my math. And then in fourth grade, I remember getting in trouble for daydreaming. And I thought the other day, that's what my job is. That's what I do every day. I have to daydream.
We have a question right here.
Hi, my name is Kathy Brodsky. I'm a clinical social worker, and I happen to write books for kids, too. Great. But I have to tell you, your Dinosaurs Divorce and Dinosaurs Die books I've used for people of all different ages, and they've been terrific.
Let's thank Laurie Krasney Brown, who's right up here. Give him a wave. Laurie worked at Harvard with the brilliant Howard Gardner for many years at Project Zero and did a lot of research of children and media. And she's so good at taking those hard issues and getting the right questions for families to talk about.
All right. What is your name?
Megan.
And what's your question, Megan?
What is your favorite Arthur video?
My favorite
Arthur video.
My favorite Arthur video? I think it's that one where D.W. dresses up like Arthur. I really think it's funny when brothers and sisters tease each other. I used to do that to my sisters. I was really a bad brother. But I thought it was funny when D.W. pretends that she's Arthur and she's driving him crazy. So that would be my... What's your favorite? You have one? You don't have a favorite one? Do you have a favorite character? Do you like it when Baby Kate and Pal talk to each other? I like that part. our young writers are so... They come up with some great ideas.
We have a question over here to your left. What's your name?
Isabel.
And what's your question, Isabel?
Where'd you get your idea from Muffy?
From Muffy? Muffy is a real character, She was my sister Bonnie's best friend. And her real name is Muffy. And her father was a Cadillac dealer. She had a Cadillac dealership in where we grew up. And she would get to drive to school every day in a new Cadillac. And we would be walking to school in the snow and the rain. And she would drive by and wave to us. It would, like, it never occurred to her to stop and offer us a ride. And her last name was Crossmire. And so I switched it to Crosswire so people wouldn't recognize her. Because she looked exactly like that.
We have a
she
question
found
now.
Out, too, by the way.
We have a question from my friend David, who I know from the library here. What's your question, David?
Okay, here's my question.
Okay. What's your question?
How many episodes are they in Arthur? Like, with the TV, how many single episodes? Like, not
how many episodes are there?
In Arthur.
Almost 200 now.
Oh, yeah?
Almost 200 episodes. And do you know that Arthur last year became the longest-running children's animated television show in history ever? I know. I can't believe it. I thought maybe 2 years, and PBS is just, they've just ordered two more seasons, and we're hard at work on those, making more episodes to watch.
So,
okay?
So we have time for one final question here, but then remember
yes,
that you can meet Mr. Brown outside
we'll
for
a
book sale and author signing. So we have one last question.
One last question.
From?
Seamus.
From Seamus, and what's your question, Seamus?
What inspired you to make the shows?
What inspired you to make the shows?
Well, like I said, I wanted kids to read. And I wanted kids to go to the library and pick out more books. And Arthur is all about reading. And when he has difficult things in his life, one of the first things he does is go to the library to try to learn about it. So that was an excellent question, Seamus. Thank you very much. And thank you all for reading my books and for watching my show.